But then if you're looking at question 74, I haven't gotten there yet. 74 says, right. So, oh, darn it. That's another colligative properties one. I clearly did not spend enough time going through this test and eliminating questions that did not apply. A soluble compound, we'll just talk about it for a second though. A soluble compound XY2 dissociates in water according to the equation above in a 0.050 molal, M-O-L-A-L, molal solution of the compound. The XY2 aqueous species is 40% dissociated. In the solution, the number of moles of particles of solute per 1 kilogram of water is closest to. And molality is moles per kilogram, whereas molarity is moles per liter. And that's why they put kilogram in there. So with a 40% dissociation, you would have to take that solution times the 0.05 times 0.4 and then divide it by 1. And this is the number of moles of particles. Oh, and then you would have to triple it probably. Let's see, what's 0.04 times, if you did that without a calculator, you would have to, oh, because it wants the number of moles of particles. You normally would have, so you're still back to the molality. So 0.4 times 0.05, isn't that like 0.002? No, that's not right. I can't think of what it is. The answer is like, is B, I think, but it's, you end up having to, oh, and you have to consider the number. Also, there's 60% of the original molecules too. So you end up with 4 times that. Oh my goodness. So much fun. You guys don't have to solve it, but so you can eliminate 74 from your questions.
Okay, so we don't have to know colligative properties at all.
At all. Here's an interesting tidbit for you, because I love talking about this stuff. Colligative properties are considered by College Board to be prior knowledge. College Board thinks that you should have learned that in general chemistry. Colligative properties is difficult. So if you look at College Board's framework for the general science classes for chemistry, Gen Chem, colligative properties are not included in general chemistry. So I don't know where they think colligative properties would fit in if they're not even putting it in their own curriculum. Anyways, you'll learn about it in college.
Ice cream, that's all I know.
Ice cream, there you go. That was the only thing, like, we're like, well, we can't just let them make ice cream. We need to make them do something. And so look at that. Yeah, they learned all kinds of molality, sort of. Not really. All right. Yeah. Just know that I'll probably, when we make ice cream this year, I'll probably make you do the exact same thing. And then you'll say, oh yeah, that's the stuff we didn't have to know. All right, what's your next question?
Ooh, I have 58 on the multiple choice.
All right. You guys are not looking at the test, right? You're looking at, oh yeah, you are.
Yeah.
Okay, 58. Let me open this up a little bit. The equilibrium system represented above is contained in a sealed rigid vessel. Which of the following will increase if the temperature of the mixture is raised? So we have our equation synthesis. We have gas molecules on both sides, 3 on the left, 2 on the right. We have a delta H of positive 104 kilojoules per mole, which means that energy was added. It's endothermic, so that means heat is a reactant. Not looking at any of the questions, or the answers, I'm sorry. If I didn't look at any of the answers, look at the question, which of the following will increase if the temperature of the mixture is raised? I would look at it and say, okay, if it's endothermic and heat was on the left side, did my little teeter-totter, I would say that I added heat to the left, which means it would shift to the right. So that means that the amount of the NOCl I would anticipate would increase. That would be my guess. Now, looking at the choices, N2 the gas, no. The rate of the Ford reaction only. Well, here's the thing about equilibrium. If we increase the rate of the Ford reaction, what's going to happen to the reverse reaction to get us back to equilibrium? It's going to have to increase as well. So the Ford reaction can't be the only one that increases because it's going to reestablish, it's going to reestablish equilibrium, which means that the reverse reaction is going to have to speed up. So B can't be right. C, the rate of the reverse reaction only. Well, that one definitely not, because that's not what initially is happening either. And then D, the rates of both the Ford and the reverse reactions. I would be tempted to put that down. And E, it's D. And E is the total number of moles of gas in the vessel. And the only way the moles... No, that's not right, because it's going to go from 3 to 2. I was going to say if we increase the volume of the container, you would get an increase in the number of moles. Because going to the right is going to produce fewer moles. So, yeah, so definitely D, and you said that was the right one, so that works out just fine. Okay. All right. Next one, 59. Ooh, if a metal X forms an ionic chloride with the formula XCl3, then which of the following formulas is most likely to be that of a stable sulfide of X? So, what I would say is that when I look at that XCl3, I think of aluminum, AlCl3. So if I have aluminum, if I want aluminum to mix with a sulfide, and just for fun, I'm going to do this for a second. Let's share the bamboo. It's just fun to say sometimes. Okay, so XCl3 is going to be the same in my mind as AlCl3. And if I'm going to do aluminum, it's going to be a 3+ because chloride was a 1-. And I'm going to combine it with sulfide, which is a sulfur, S2-. So I'm going to do swap and drop. And I'm going to come up with Al2S3. So I would say that the formula should be X2S3. And so was that answer... So that's answer B. Was that the right answer? Looks like it is.
So do you just have to replace X with something from the same group?
That's correct. Yes.
Okay.
That's the way that I have found to be the easiest.
Okay.
I mean, you could do it with that. I like the application. I like to figure out what's going on. If you just want to do it theoretically, you could say, well, reverse, if it's XCl3, doing reverse would go here. And then the one would go here. And so the X would have to be a... Oh, Caitlin Clark. Oh, bye, Caitlin. Oh, she already left. Okay. The X would be a 3+, and Cl would be a 1-. And then you could do the X 3+ with the S 2-, and then you could do swap and drop that way too. But I like to look at what the application is so I can see. It makes more sense to me. All right, so that was number 59. Do we have another question?
Oh, how? Okay. I also didn't really understand number 50 on the multiple choice.
50, all right, let's take a look. Suppose that during the experiment, a significant amount of water from the ice bath adhered to the ice cubes. Oh, this is a problem with a few things. Okay. How does this affect the calculated value for the heat of fusion of ice? So you were doing the nested coffee cup calorimeter, and you had warm water, and then you added ice cubes, and then it was stirred as the ice melted in the lowest temperature. Okay. So looking at 50... So that means that water from the ice bath, which means that cold water was added with the ice. So that's interesting. If you're calculating the heat of fusion of ice, here's the problem. Okay. So what's happening is that you're considering, Well, let me see this. Okay, you're considering the water that was carried over on the ice to be part of the mass of the ice. And when you do the delta H of fusion, that's the amount of energy it takes to move the ice from the solid, the water from the solid at 0 degrees, to the liquid at 0 degrees. And the water that was on the ice cube was already was at 0 degrees, but it was already water. So there it wouldn't take as much energy to get that ice to zero, all of that mass to from solid to liquid, because some of it's already liquid. So if you look at these, let's look at these choices. The calculated value is too large because less warm water had to be cooled. That's incorrect. Because there was the same amount of warm water. It was the amount of cold or ice that was added. So the calculated value is too large because more cold water had to be heated. No, because we're still talking about the heat of fusion. It's not the water that had to be, but rather the ice. So C, the calculated value is too small because less ice was added in the student soup. Now that part I would go for because, again, it's going to take less energy to get the, based upon the mass that you added, it would take less energy to get that solid to liquid. Let's see, D, the calculated value is too small because the total mass of the calorimeter contents was too large. No, because the mass of the water on the ice is also considered. When you mass the cup and its contents were weighed again, that's where you got the mass. And so the mass being too large, that is not true. That's not a possibility. And E, there is no effect on the calculated value because the water adhered to the ice cubes was there. No, see, that's the whole point of the heat of fusion. So I'm going to go with C. The calculated value is too small because less ice was added in the student soup. So there's less mass of the ice, and so takes less energy. Okay, does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good. Yeah, that one's a tough one. That is a tough one. I remember that one when I gave the final the first time, when I gave this as a final the first time, that was a question that was missed quite frequently. All right, other questions? Multiple choice number 64. Okay. As the reaction represented above proceeds to the right, the oxidation number of chlorine changes from, let's share the bamboo. And oxidation numbers, always fun. And this one's much, or at least I hope, it was much easier than the Chem Olympiad exam. Okay. HCl. All right. So what we have going on here is, well, this is O2. This is automatically zero. Not a big deal. In this HClO, the H is pretty much always going to be plus one. The oxygen is going to be negative two. And so the chlorine would have to be a plus one to make this one zero. On this side, if we have negative two here, that's negative eight. And this is plus one. So that means that chlorine is now going to have to be plus seven. There's only one of it. To make that molecule neutral. So it's going to go from a plus one to a plus seven. So I would go for D on this one. And so I think that's the right answer. Is that the right answer? 64. Yes. So when you're looking at a molecule that has three elements in it.
Oh, I'm back.
You're back. Welcome back, Kylie. when you're doing this, the ones on the outside usually are pretty set in their oxidation numbers. It's usually like, I'm trying to think, you usually have hydrogen and oxygen on the outside. To be totally honest with you, that's what happens quite frequently. So you have like HNO3, H2SO4, or even H2SO3. And in these situations, all of them, the oxygens are -2 and the hydrogens are +1. And that's one of the rules that you kind of have to memorize a little bit. But hydrogen is pretty much always +1. Very infrequently is it not +1. Unless it's with a metal, like an alkali metal like KH. And then the alkali metals are +1 because it is always +1. In that case, the hydrogen is -1. And then oxygen is -2 almost always, except for when it's in a peroxide like H2O2. And then it's +1. And then it's oxygen's a -1. Or if it's with fluorine, which of course the fluorine's always going to be -1 because it is the most electronegative element. So in this situation, the oxygen is going to be a +2. But for the most part, those are very extreme examples. You're going to be pretty safe. Hydrogen's going to be +1, oxygen's going to be -2, and then you just have to balance it out. So if we're looking at HNO3, the oxygen is -2, and there's three of them, so that means the total negative charge is -6. There's one hydrogen, it's +1, so it's, and there's only one atom, so it's +1. So to get these all together to be equal to 0, that means that nitrogen's total is going to have to be +5. And there just happens to be only one nitrogen, so it gets the +5. So hopefully that makes sense, Caitlin. But yeah, that's the oxidation state. All right. Are there other questions? You know, while we're on, I'm just thinking about this. So if you guys are thinking, let me change pen color for a second since I'm going to change topics. We're talking about acids, HClO versus HClO2, HClO3, and HClO4. And if you remember from your acid-base unit, the HClO4 is the perchloric acid, and that's your strong acid. That's one of the six strong acids. It's the strongest of the four of these. And when we talk about our molecules, we have an OH attached to an O attached to the chlorine. And so for each one of these, you're going to just end up adding oxygens to the outside. Oops. I didn't mean to do that. The more oxygens that you add, the stronger it becomes because there's more, it's going to start, for every oxygen you add, it's going to pull the electronegativity or pull the electrons more this way, which means that this hydrogen is going to be easier to remove, which means it's going to dissociate more easily, and that makes it the strong acid. Now, if we're comparing, the strength goes this direction. So the more oxygens you add to that central atom, the stronger the acid becomes. If you are comparing, since we were already doing this, HClO, and let's say I had O3 here. Oops, I drew that incorrectly. Let me try that again. If I have let's just do this, HClO. And I was comparing that versus HBrO, okay? And if you remember correctly that if HCl versus HBr, okay, and which one is the stronger acid?
Is it HBrO?
That's correct, because Cl is more electronegative. So this means it's a stronger acid. It's not going to hold on to the H as well. It's not going to hold on to the H as strongly. In this situation, you have the chlorine and the oxygen, right? And so the oxygen is pulling on the chlorine, In the same way that, this is a horrible looking R. Okay, the oxygen is pulling on this bromine right here. So here's a question for you. Which one of these do you think would be a stronger acid? The HClO or the HBrO?
HBrO?
Okay, and why do you think that?
More of the electrons would go toward the oxygen side.
Yes.
So the side by the hydrogen would be more positive and they'd be more repulsive towards each other.
Good, good. Because this oxygen is so much more electronegative than the bromine. It's going to be pulling this electron cloud closer to the oxygen, which means you're right. It's going to release that hydrogen, which means that this is going to be the stronger acid again. Whereas the chlorine, the oxygen, the chlorine and oxygen are kind of fighting with each other a little bit more. So it's, whereas the electron cloud, if we're going to draw an imaginary electron cloud over here, it would be more around the oxygen. This is shared a little bit more equally. And so it's closer. So it's going to hold that hydrogen a little bit more strongly. So this one is the weaker compared to these two. So it happens to be the same way, interestingly enough, but I don't want you to get thrown off by those oxygen. I want you to be able to think about and understand how the electronegativities of the atoms plays in. And don't forget that, of course, I mean, the last thing I just as a reminder, so this is, we're talking about HBr. So HBrO is weaker though than HBrO2 because you've added more oxygens. It's pulling more of it away. Okay, multiple choice number 57. All right. Oh, this is a fun one. Let me share that. All right. So which of the following is true for the process represented above at 327 degrees Celsius and 1 atmosphere. The normal melting point of lead solid is 327 degrees Celsius. So we have solid going to liquid. It's in equilibrium. The normal melting point is 327 and it's 1 atmosphere. So these are, it's sort of like standard conditions for, not really standard, it's standard at pressure, let's just say that. And that's, but the temperature is not standard. So it's not truly standard state, which is why you don't see any of those not symbols on the delta H, delta S, or delta G. So it's at 327, the normal melting point is this. So it's in equilibrium. So if it's in equilibrium, what does that mean for these different equations? Delta H being equal to zero. Delta H being equal to zero is just telling you whether heat's going in or heat's going out. And delta H is zero only for, well, it's really got to be a change in heat. And so you've got to have delta H of a substance changing from one to the other. And this would not be it because you have it in equilibrium. Like there's some shifting back and forth. So, and you have and delta H is equal to zero for an element in its standard state at standard conditions. So A couldn't be right. T delta S. Okay, now when it looks at this, now I'm reminded that, you know what, this might be dealing with a different equation. So let's go, I'm going to share my bamboo paper again. And let's go to the next page. Can you guys see the bamboo paper okay? Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's go back to blue. So delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S. So maybe what we're dealing with is this equation. And so looking at that, the T delta S is temperature times the entropy, the inherent entropy of the system. And delta S is almost never zero. It's usually got a positive or negative. Usually it's changing in a way. And this is, it's going from a solid to a liquid, which means entropy would be increasing. But regardless, you're going to get some sort of number here. So that means that can't be zero. Delta S is less than zero. Oh, and we just said that more than likely that a solid going to a liquid, that delta S would have to be increasing because the disorder of the system or the randomness of the system is increasing moving from a solid to liquid. So C is out. You have D, which is delta H equals T delta G. I have not seen an answer like that before. To get that to happen, I'm not even sure how you would do that. That doesn't make sense. But E, where to get, in order to get delta H equals T delta S, that means that delta G would have to be equal to zero. And the only time when delta G is equal to zero is at equilibrium. So that means that this is your correct answer. Or at least I hope it is. Is that the right answer?
Yes.
Number 57. Good. So, yeah, trying to remember that whenever you have an equilibrium system, that sometimes they're looking for this, like delta G is equal to zero or some manipulation of the equation to find that some other, like the delta H or the delta S. Yeah, that happens in the thermodynamics questions quite frequently and the multiple choice. All right. Other questions?
How does 66 work?
66. Well, let's check it out. Oh, I went right past it. Oh, 66. That one's a fun one. Okay. So, without a calculator, no less. So let me share that one and we can look at it. And then I can tell you where I think I would start and then we can do the problem and see if you get it. All right. So at 25 degrees Celsius, a saturated solution of a metal hydroxide, which is some metal times hydroxide 2. So the metal has to be an alkaline earth metal. It's got a positive 2 charge. Has a pH of 9.0. What is the value of the solubility product constant, Ksp, of MOH2 as a solid at 25 degrees Celsius? So I think what you're going to end up doing is using the pH to find the H+. Actually, you can do the pH to find the POH first, and then use the POH to get the OH minus, and then you could plug it in to solve for Ksp. And again, this should all be able to be done without a calculator. And let's see if we can do it. So now I'm going to share the bamboo paper. Oh, this is going to be fun. This is one of those questions where I'm hoping that you guys will say, oh, I can do this. It's just going to take me a little bit longer. This is a second pass question. So we have a pH, which pH plus POH equals 14. So I'm writing all this out. You obviously don't want to write this out. You can do this in your head. So if 9 plus POH is equal to 14, then POH would have to be equal to 5. If POH is equal to 5, then the OH minus concentration would be have to be equal to 1 times 10 to the negative 5th. And if we have the Ksp, Ksp is going to be equal to the M2 plus times the OH minus squared. So that's going to be equal to, if our OH minus is 1 times 10 to the negative 5th, what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to put that in half, because this is, it's usually x and 2x then squared. Well, if this is equal to 2x then, that means that x is equal to 1 times 10 to the negative 5th over 2. So if I can do this right, we're going to see 1 times 10 to the negative 5th divided by 2. So that's basically, well, we'll do that in a second, times the 1 times 10 to the negative 5th squared. Oh, man. So my guess is that this is a 0.5 times 10 to the, and basically this is doubling this, and then adding this. So 10 to the negative 5th plus negative 10. So I've got 0.5 times 10 to the negative 15th. And if I want to move that over 1, I'm so sorry, I'm running out of room down here. I would get 5 times 10 to the negative 16th. Does that look right to everybody?
Yeah.
Kind of? And that would make it D? I think that's it. So it would take you a couple minutes to do, but recognizing probably the hiccup came from having to given a pH, like what do I do with that? And that is because you want to find the OH minus concentration, which is then plugged into the KSP problem. Yeah, that one's I guess it's not too bad once you get farther into it, but it can look like a doozy on the surface. Those KSP problems are not the funnest to work through. Okay, are there other questions?
Can you do 1D on the free response?
Sure. What I'm probably going to do is show you the key and work through it at the same time. But so 1D, I should probably just share the document right now. There we go. One D says an open container holds 1 liter of 0.00400 molar lead chloride, which is unsaturated at 25 degrees Celsius. Calculate the minimum volume of water in milliliters that must evaporate from the container before solid lead chloride can precipitate. And they give you a KSP of 3.2 times 10 to the negative 9th.
No, the KSP is 1.6 times 10 to the negative 5th. It's slower.
Oops, I am so sorry. You are right. I apologize. 1.6 times 10 to the negative 5th. All right, so I imagine what you're going to have to do is use this right here to find the molarity based upon the way we just did that problem. The KSP is equal to the concentration of lead times the concentration of, well, concentration of lead times the concentration of 2 chloride squared. You would find the S. And S would give you the molarity of the lead, which is the molarity of the lead chloride, at which it precipitates. And once you do that, you can find out, so how much water would have to leave, given the moles. Okay, so let's go to the answers and work through it together. So 1D. Okay. So it gives you the number of moles of right, lead 2 plus, and moles of the chloride. Let V be the volume of the solution. Oh, interesting. I don't think I would have gone that route necessarily. I would have determined from part C the amount of is 1.6 times 10 to the negative 2. So I would have done it this way in this second part right here, where, and I didn't look at, so C, you were actually finding the concentration of chloride. And so the chloride wasn't as important as finding the lead, which was the 1.6 times 10 to the negative 2. Since that's what we were talking about, the molarity of the lead is the same as the molarity of the lead chloride. So the way that I would have solved it is saying that the 1.6 times 10 to the negative 2 is the molarity of the Pb, which is the molarity of the PbCl2. And that's when there's 1 liter. That's how many moles in 1 liter. Well, if you actually only have 0.00400 moles, what volume would you have to have the same conditions to have it precipitate? And so this little cross multiplication gives you the 250 milliliters. And the question, of course, asks how much must evaporate? So you're gonna have to take your original volume, subtract it from the volume at which it precipitates to give you the amount that it changes. This question is similar to the way sometimes questions are worded in acid-base problems where they say, how much water would you have to add to dilute it to the new concentration? And so when you do the M1 V1 equals M2 V2, you're just subtracting the two volumes to find what the amount of water that was added. And that's what they're hearing. What's the water change? And so this one is going to be tricky. It's one of those ones in which you have to read it really carefully. And I would totally admit that if I was a student doing this problem, I would have done it wrong. I would have listed 250 milliliters because I would not have read this carefully enough to see the minimum volume of water. It's not asking for the amount that's in there when you're doing the molarity. It's the change. What is the change in volume? So does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Marina, yes. Okay, so Marina, the way the extra credit's going to work is you don't have to come in at 6:30. However much you complete this week, you can come in before school any day this week or at lunch any day this week and just keep working on this practice test. And so as much as you do is as much extra credit as you will earn. If you did the whole thing, you would get the full 20 points in the test category, which right now would be a 2.5% boost to your grade. Or if you only got halfway done on each of them, then you would get 10 points, which is whatever, 1.25%. So it's just as much as you can do. I really didn't intend for this to steal time from your other classes. So that's why it's just extra credit. Oh, and we lost. Okay, well, I won't be there tomorrow, but I want, okay. So whenever you come is fine. And Kylie left, and I hope everything's okay. And actually, we're kind of getting close to the end here. I will take another, like, let's say one more question or two more questions if they're really pressing. Because we still have two more. Go ahead.
So if we get the entire test done, will you score it on the AP scale for us?
I'm going to make the key available to you so you can check your work. Yeah, I'm not gonna take the time to grade it. I want you guys to do it and then check your work and see where you're going with it.
Okay.
But it all has to stay in the classroom.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
What are we doing in class tomorrow?
So tomorrow, and as I was going through this, it reminded me, I will probably talk about some test strategies. So, you know, how to approach some of the math and approach the multiple choice and the free response. So, but I only want to take about 10 minutes to do that. There are a couple things looking at the final exam that I want to emphasize and remind you guys to study, and kind of like a spoiler alert. Class is only 45 minutes long. So, I don't want it to, you know, it's going to go by super fast. So in our next class, then Wednesday is the multiple choice test. Now we don't have to come early or stay late because now the period is blocked up to 90 minutes. So we just show up, we start at the beginning of the period, we end at the end of the period, and you don't have to devote any extra time to it, which is nice. So needless to say though, that it just feels like it's coming up really fast. And so I want to be able to provide you a form to ask some questions, which is the Google Hangouts as well. But I also want to, you know, give a little inspirational, motivational speech because I think that sometimes it can feel overwhelming. So it's kind of a mix of things tomorrow.
Do you think we'll have time for any review? Because I was kind of like trying to decide whether or not I should bring my crash course book.
You mean you? Oh, time like for you guys to study on your own, like in small groups?
Yeah.
I would imagine there would be some time for that.
Okay.
Which, by the way, I just also want to mention that that a couple other teachers have gone on the listserv, on the discussion board, is saying that Adrian's book is probably the best book out there right now for studying from for the AP Chem exam.
I like it so far. I think it has really good explanations.
Good. And I don't know if you've tried the online stuff at all, like there's an online test or whatever, but that could be another good way to review if you have time.
Yeah, I haven't done that yet. I was thinking maybe next weekend, like before the test. I don't know.
Yeah. No, I think that's good. Okay.
So is Tuesday and Wednesday the only 2 days this week, the long schedule or the long periods?
No, we have the 90-minute periods are going to be Tuesday through Friday, because Tuesday, well, I mean, the junior, you guys have EAP or the English and the math, and I feel horrible that you guys have so much testing and I'm lumping AP final exam on top of that. But you guys have, so they're blocking this 90 minutes for the whole week for you guys and for the sophomores who have to take the life science test.
So we take it in our math and language arts classes, right?
Absolutely, yeah. If you guys end up needing more time, I guess you're going to be allowed to go late to your next class. But really, for the most part, it should be able to be completed within the 90 minutes.
Okay.
So there's no plus at all this week?
There is no plus at all this week, and lunch is only a half an hour all week.
So this is kind of a random question, but do you know if plus period grades go in for this week?
Yes, by Tuesday I have to have in my passes and my no marks, no comments, no anything else, just P or NM. But plus won't come into effect until, I guess, starting Tuesday of the first week of AP exams.
Okay.
But I'll have to be honest with you, at this point, I mean, for my class, for my AP class, I don't really feel like putting anybody in plus. I mean, it's basically the end of all of our curriculum. There's no point in doing it. You're either there or you're not. And putting you in plus at this point is going to do no good. My chem classes, it's a whole different story, but.
Yeah. Well, I was just worried. I have just something that I need to make up in another class, and I haven't had a chance to fix it. So I was just kind of concerned on whether or not it'd be put into plus, since I won't have had a chance to fix it in any plus period or anything.
Right. But you're going to have to talk to the teacher on that one.
Okay.
I mean, different teachers approach it slightly differently. For my general chem class, we just gave them a test on Thursday and Friday. And for that, let's say that eighth period on Tuesday. Oh, actually, my Silver Day classes will not have had an opportunity to correct any of their essential skills. And so because of that, I don't think it's really fair to do it for the Blue Day either. In fact, I'm not even doing essential skills tomorrow for Blue Day. So so for my Gen Chem classes, because we haven't even met as a class yet, I'm not, for this most recent test, if they're missing essential skill, they're not going into plus for that. But that was the way that I'm approaching it. I can't speak for the other teachers, so I definitely want to talk to them.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, I didn't realize that we didn't have plus this week because I had made plans to like fix it on Tuesday.
Oh, yes. Totally makes sense.
After the exam, are we still going to have a lot of homework and projects and things?
Oh, heavens no. I'm not. My goal is to not have homework for AP Chem. I would say that I want us to do projects, I want us to do some labs and activities, but there's going to be nothing like what we've done before. There might be a couple things, and it depends on what you guys are interested in doing as well. One year I had the classes make videos of general, like Gen Chem essential skills and things that I could post, and they were pretty good, but it turns out that they were not I mean, it wasn't quite to the level that I could post it for the Gen Chem kids, but it was a good opportunity to learn how to teach a concept. And so for that one, students had homework as far as like how they were going to approach it, but it was kind of a fun thing, and we did a lot of it in class anyhow. But I can't think of any other thing where I did where it was like homework. And for the next 2 weeks, I mean, once we get into AP exams, I'm not going to assign any homework during the AP weeks, the AP exam weeks. And that leaves us only like another week or two after that. So,
yeah. Okay, that makes me so happy. You have no idea.
Well, good. I'm glad.
Oh, my classes are still piling on homework, and I'm just like, okay, I don't
have time. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, AP chemistry is such a difficult class that you've earned a respite from this. And I don't know, did I mention it to your class that I know of teachers that, I mean, granted they go to private schools, but their students don't even have to come to class after the AP exam.
Lucky.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah, we need to work on doing that for our school.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I don't think that's going to happen. I will say this, that I definitely like the opportunity to come and, you know, and there's always something interesting to do and some kind of fun, some applications, and figure out some way to do that. But yeah, I hear what you're saying.
Yeah, we should do labs without the lab write-up.
Yes, I agree.
Tie-dye.
And tie, yeah. I think that in my mind, I'd like to do an electrochem lab, and I would like to do tie-dye, and I think that we usually do ice cream with the Gen Chem, so of course we do ice cream with you guys. So there are at least 3 days of fun lesson plans, and then we'll figure out the others later.
Sounds good.
All right. Anything else for you guys? You guys good?
Good.
All right. Well, then I will see you all tomorrow morning.
Okay.
All right. Get some rest tonight. Bye.
Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.